Anastasia Pulyasa is going to chair the session, so we will have 20 minutes talk. Each speaker is going to talk for 20 minutes, and then right after each presentation, we'll have 10 minutes of session, and we'll move on from there. So let's welcome Silvio Marino, Federico Maria Petrucci, and Chad Jorgensen. Silvio Marino has this talk entitled Socrate, Fisico dell'Idea, Semantica ed Etica e Semantica Fisica dell'Epedone. Silvio Marino completed his PhD at the University of Naples, Federico II, under the supervision of Professor Giovanni Casertano, with the dissertation Interactions Between Platonic Dialogue and Ancient Medieval Thought, a study starting from the Protagoras of Plato. His work deals with Plato, the Corpus Hippocraticum, and ancient aesthetics. After graduating at the University of Federico II, he pursued a period of research at the CNRS of Villejuif at the Sorbonne University. He was assigned a postdoctoral fellowship at the University of São Paulo, USP, and Campinas, Unicamp, and he has published several articles, and is co-editor of Ekphrasis, a monographic issue of the journal Estetica, Studi e Ricerche. He took part in many international conferences in Italy, France. He traveled all over the world. He's a fellow in the history of ancient philosophy, Cultore della Materia, and professor of history and philosophy at the Italian State High School.
So, thank you. Leggerò in italiano la mia conferenza e salterò dei passi per brevità. In questa mia breve comunicazione mi occuperò dell'ultimo argomento del Fedone in relazione alla contrarietà diretta e indiretta tra pragma e idea e tra idea e idea. Attraverso il riferimento al passo del Timeo 56-57 cercherò di mostrare come si possa scorgere una relazione analogica tra piano dei pragmata e piano delle idee, che pragmata, idee ed eide osservano i medesimi tipi di relazione, che tali relazioni dipendono da compatibilità e incompatibilità semantiche, ovvero da congiunzione e disgiunzione. E in ultimo suggerirò che con questo passo Platone inaugura una semiotica del mondo naturale. L'ultimo argomento del Fedone presenta un'interessante quanto problematica discussione sui contrari, considerati sia a livello eidetico sia a livello fisico. Ed è il concetto stesso di ente fisico a subire una riconfigurazione, in quanto esso cessa di essere cosa e attraverso l'introduzione degli eide come cause diviene un nucleo semantico. Dal passo preso in considerazione, l'ente fisico si trova a essere una fenomenizzazione di un'idea. L'idea infatti occupa la cosa e le conferisce sia il nome sia le qualità fisiche. Un ente ha quindi determinate qualità e determinate qualificazioni in quanto partecipe di una o più idee. Anzi, le qualità fisiche possono essere davvero comprese soltanto alla luce della partecipazione dell'ente a una o più idee. Ciò si apprende dalla discussione sulla grandezza. Simia è grande non perché è simia, ma in quanto partecipe dell'idea di grande. La discussione sui contrari parte dal principio per il quale un contrario in sé non può tollerare di accogliere il proprio contrario rimanendo identico a se stesso. In 102 e 103a Socrate enuncia il principio logico e ontologico da cui prendere mosse il mio breve intervento. E cito: «E nessun altro dei contrari, finché è ciò che era, consente di diventare né di essere contemporaneamente il suo contrario, ma nel subire una cosa simile o si allontana o perisce». Un anonimo interlocutore ricorda allora l'argomento dei contrari, quello di 70 e seguenti, obiettando che prima si era detto l'esatto contrario, cioè che da contrari si generano contrari. A questo punto Socrate ribatte mettendo in luce la differenza con l'argomento precedente, in quanto nel discorso di prima si trattava di pragmata. Da un pragma nasce il pragma contrario. L'argomento di cui si discute nell'ultimo argomento verte invece sui contrari in sé e non sulle cose contrarie. Ciò che desta un po' di sospetto quanto alla legittimità del ragionamento è che in questo passo, una volta enunciato questo principio, Socrate, come primo esempio, adduce dei principi fisici, il caldo e il freddo, che però sono subito messi in relazione a due pragmata, cioè il fuoco e la neve, che vengono analizzati in base a due principi contrari ai quali partecipano. Fuoco e neve, quindi, in quanto pragmata che hanno sempre in sé i principi contrari, non possono essere l'uno accanto all'altro, altrimenti o periscono o cambiano luogo. Molti studiosi hanno notato la vicinanza di questo passo con quello di Timeo 56-57, in cui i mutamenti degli elementi sono descritti e spiegati attraverso la terminologia guerrisca. Passo dopo le citazioni del Timeo. Il principio che presiede ai mutamenti di luogo, così come ai mutamenti qualitativi, è il principio della somiglianza e dissomiglianza. Il lessico utilizzato è chiaro al riguardo. Tra elementi o enti, homoia e siugene, non vi può essere combattimento né mutamento. Quando invece si produce una differenza tra un elemento e gli altri elementi che lo circondano, allora si produce una battaglia, un'opposizione che prevede o l'assimilazione dell'elemento più debole a quello più forte o il cambiamento di luogo verso l'elemento congenere. E passo oltre. Da questi passi del Timeo, strettamente legati a mio avviso al passo del Fedone, tre sono gli aspetti da sottolineare. Un primo aspetto riguarda i principi e le dinamiche sottese ai cambi di stato della materia. La somiglianza e l'uniformità non danno luogo a mutamenti, mentre la differenza e la non uniformità generano mutamenti che nella metafora guerrisca sono battaglie. Ciò significa che elementi differenti operano di fatto come elementi contrari che generano opposizione. Il secondo aspetto riguarda la stretta prossimità di questa concezione del Timeo con il trattato pseudo-ippocratico del regime, libro 1, capitolo 6, in cui i mutamenti delle particelle vengono descritti in termini di guerra, c'è proprio il verbo machetai. Un terzo aspetto importante per l'economia del Fedone è che in questa dinamica degli enti fisici viene ripresa proprio l'indagine per i fusios che era stata abbandonata. Ritornando a Fedone, in effetti, se volessimo attribuire un riferimento per l'esempio di caldo, freddo e fuoco, neve, non potremmo non guardare proprio al regime. In questo testo, infatti, i due principi esplicativi della realtà fisica sono fuoco e acqua, che hanno proprietà come proprietà caratteristiche le classiche coppie caldo, freddo e secco, umido. Il discorso, in altre parole, ritorna sull'indagine per i fusios e per di più invalida quanto era stato argomentato a proposito dei pragmata contrari. Dalla neve non si genererà mai il fuoco, né dal fuoco la neve. Il problema di questo passo, in una incongruenza a mio avviso, risiedono proprio nell'esempio addotto, perché invece di trattare del caldo e del freddo in sé, Platone tratta del fuoco e della neve, che sono cose. Alla luce di queste considerazioni, Socrate enuncia il seguente principio, cito Fedone 103 e 2.5: non solo l'idea stessa merita il suo nome per sempre, ma c'è anche qualcosa di diverso da quella che però possiede sempre la forma di quella, finché esiste. Ci troviamo di fronte a un'altra perplessità, perché viene chiamata in causa la questione del nome. Ma a complicare maggiormente questa sorta di dimostrazione interviene l'esempio successivo, quello della disparità e del 3. A rigor di logica, se l'esempio è analogo al precedente, il 3 dovrebbe essere una cosa che partecipa alla disparità e che pertanto, pur non essendo contrario al pari, non può essere in contatto con esso, perché altrimenti o perirebbe o cambierebbe luogo. Il discorso, a mio avviso, viaggia, se possibile, su di un terreno ancora più scivoloso, perché occorre chiedersi che cos'è il 3? Una cosa o un'idea? Ci si potrebbe chiedere anche se il fuoco e la neve non possano essere anch'essi delle idee e se queste due idee abbiano gli stessi rapporti delle cose fuoco e neve in relazione al caldo e al freddo. Non penso che possa essere tracciata qui una linea netta di demarcazione tra cose e idee, perché uno, il fuoco e la neve sono anche idee e le cose fuoco e neve si devono comportare come le rispettive idee, essendo queste paradigmatiche rispetto alla realtà sensibile. Due, i pragmata hanno la propria determinazione non in quanto pragmata determinati, ma in quanto partecipano a determinate idee. Il 3 è un'idea, e perché se le idee servono a uscire dall'impasse in cui Anassagora aveva gettato Socrate, i pragmata devono essere analizzati alla luce di una metodologia che introduce Hegel, ovvero considerati non in quanto cose, ma in quanto epifenomeni di una realtà, metodologia, che è al di là del piano fisico. L'argomentazione impone una riflessione non tanto sulla partecipazione degli enti fisici alle idee, quanto una riflessione sul carattere analogico dei piani fisico ed eidetico e sulle relazioni alla base degli elementi in ciascuno di questi piani. Il discorso platonico verte sui pragmata, che sono occupati da un contrario in sé, cioè da un'idea. Tali pragmata non potranno mai accettare l'avvicinarsi, in una metafora spaziale che intendo con comunicare con, di un'idea contraria a quella che recano in sé in maniera coessenziale, All'approssimarsi del freddo, il fuoco o perirà o cambierà luogo. Il discorso platonico, però, non esplicita la relazione fondante, ovvero quella dell'idea del fuoco con l'idea del caldo e del freddo. Possiamo dire che all'approssimarsi dell'idea del freddo l'idea del fuoco o perisce o cambia luogo? La risposta mi sembrerebbe positiva, perché ritengo implicito questo passaggio nell'esempio del fuoco e della neve ed esplicito per il caso del tre. Infatti, benché l'argomentazione all'inizio debba considerare il tre come pragma, poco oltre entra in scena l'idea del tre, etontrion idea, Fedone 104 di 5-6, e si comprende che l'essere tre di una cosa dipende dall'occupazione di un pragma da parte dell'idea del tre. E cito: tu sai infatti che le cose occupate dall'idea del tre non solo necessariamente sono tre, ma anche dispari. Fine citazione. Un pragma è quindi insieme tre, numero e dispari, in quanto occupato dall'idea del tre. Questa occupazione, tuttavia, non è neutra quanto alle relazioni che si stabiliscono tra la cosa tre e le idee contrarie a quelle del tre e della disparità. E cito Fedone 104, B7, C3. Non solo i contrari manifestamente non accolgono gli uni gli altri, ma anche quelle cose che, pur non essendo contrarie tra di loro, hanno sempre in sé i contrari. Sembra che neppure queste possano accogliere l'idea contraria a quella che è presente in esse, ma avvicinandosi questa operiscono o cedono il posto. Non diremo che il tre perirà o subirà qualsiasi altra cosa prima di tollerare, restando tre, di diventare pari? Da ciò si possono ricavare varie conseguenze. Innanzitutto, il pragma non ha in sé qualità fisiche né qualificazioni, esso le mutua dall'idea che lo occupa. L'idea che occupa un pragma porta con sé non soltanto essa stessa, ma tutte le implicazioni e le relazioni che essa intrattiene con le altre idee. Il pragma quindi si troverà ad avere le stesse connotazioni essenziali dell'idea a cui partecipa. Inoltre, da quest'ultimo passo si può ricavare non soltanto che le relazioni tra pragmata sono omologhe, nel senso di remas, a quelle tra idee, ma che qui più che altro si sta discutendo proprio delle relazioni tra idee che non sono contrarie in sé, ma che si ritrovano su di un piano di contrarietà dovuta alle relazioni che intrattengono con altre idee. In altre parole, se le cose sono determinate dalle idee che le occupano e le relazioni che esse intrattengono con cose differenti dipendono dalle caratteristiche delle idee, allora possiamo dedurre da questo passo che quando si discute di cose, in realtà si sta discutendo delle caratteristiche delle idee e delle loro relazioni reciproche. A questo punto ci possiamo chiedere che tipo di relazioni vi sia alla base della strutturazione delle idee, o almeno alla base di questo tipo di idee. Alla luce di questo passo, penso che si possa individuare chiaramente un tipo di relazione basato sui principi del simile e del dissimile, che riposa dal punto di vista fisico e semantico sui concetti di incompatibilità e contrasto. L'omologia tra piano eidetico e piano fisico, che viene qui posta, mi sembra essere pertinente rispetto al problema posto dalla seconda navigazione. La critica alla fisica di Anassagora sfociava nella ricerca di cause che potessero rendere ragione dei fenomeni fisici, cause ritrovate nelle idee. Tuttavia, la riconsiderazione eidetica dei fenomeni fisici apre a un altro punto problematico, ovvero, nella prospettiva di questo passo, a una specularità tra piano fisico e piano eidetico. Tale specularità, però, a mio avviso, non indica una duplicazione, ma la posizione dei fenomeni fisici sul piano della semanticità, che rende ragione delle relazioni oppositive e analogiche chiamate in causa nel breve passo analizzato. Sebbene non vi sia nel Fedone una discussione sulla koinonia tongenon, sono molti gli studiosi che ve la vedono in luce o sottesa, e con la discussione sul fuoco e la neve e sul tre, Platone apre a una prospettiva estremamente problematica, che tuttavia esplicita il senso della seconda navigazione e getta luce sulla natura degli enti fisici e delle idee. L'ipotesi delle idee, così come è posta qui, da un lato apre a una semanticità sia delle idee sia degli enti fisici, dall'altro pone il problema della struttura e delle relazioni tra le idee. Torniamo all'esempio di fuoco e neve. Il pragma fuoco è tale perché è occupato dall'idea del fuoco. Lo stesso si dica per il pragma neve. Le relazioni con il caldo e il freddo quindi si giocano sul piano eidetico. Posto ciò, però, la struttura base della relazione non è soltanto di compatibilità, incompatibilità o di complementarità e contrasto, ma di congiunzione e disgiunzione. Il fuoco non è freddo non indica un primo livello di indagine, opposizione o contraddizione, ma incompatibilità tra la cosa e il predicato. Questo è il senso della differenza tra opposizione e contrasto, per cui l'opposizione è un caso particolare di contrasto, ovvero un contrasto binario. Il passaggio dal contrasto non binario al contrasto binario si gioca a livello delle caratteristiche coessenziali che, usando un linguaggio preso in prestito dalla semantica strutturale, potremmo genericamente chiamare semi. Dalla scomposizione dell'idea del fuoco, allora potremmo avere caldo e secco in opposizione ai semi della neve freddo e della neve, cioè freddo e umido. Queste unità minime di contenuto si strutturano in relazioni binarie per opposizione. È quanto fa qui, a mio avviso, Platone. In questa prospettiva, le relazioni tra fuoco e neve possono essere rappresentate attraverso il quadrato semiotico elaborato da Grinas, per cui si avrebbe, insomma, il caldo S1, freddo S2, fuoco S2, non S2, neve non S1. Questo quadrato si adatta bene al passo del Fedone in questione, perché le relazioni di contrarietà perché la relazione di contrarietà si ha nei due lati orizzontali, caldo-freddo, fuoco-neve, mentre la relazione di contraddittorietà viene indicata dalle diagonali, caldo-neve e fuoco-freddo. Se c'è il caldo non c'è la neve, se c'è il freddo non c'è il fuoco, il che è proprio quanto dice Socrate. Per approdare a questo risultato, Platone sceglie con cura gli esempi per mettere in evidenza e sfruttare le posizioni esistenti. Utilizzando questo metodo, però, Platone divide la realtà naturale, e quindi è identica, in due classi di elementi, in cui quelli dell'una si oppongono a quelli dell'altra. A reggere il discorso e l'argomentazione sono i due principi della somiglianza e della dissomiglianza, il primo indicante una coinonia, una comunicazione, per me più che comunanza, il secondo una esclusione, ovvero la congiunzione e la disgiunzione, che sono per Grimas la struttura elementare della significazione. Se la particolarizzazione degli eide determina le cose e le loro reciproche relazioni, ciò, come ho tentato di proporre, significa che le cose, assumendo il nome e le caratteristiche dell'eidos cui ciascuna partecipa, sono rivelatrici delle relazioni tra idee. In altri termini, le cose significano le idee e possiamo osservare le relazioni tra enti fisici come relazioni tra idee. Il fuoco e la neve sono anch'essi eide, altrimenti la cosa fuoco e la cosa neve non avrebbero né il nome né le proprie caratteristiche. In questa prospettiva, dire che le cose significano le idee è dire che le cose sono segni delle idee e rimandano necessariamente a esse. A questo punto possiamo spingerci oltre, perché il carattere di segno che la cosa acquisisce apre alla possibilità di una semiotica del mondo naturale. E svolgo queste considerazioni in relazione alla semiotica del mondo naturale, così come è stata bozzata da Grimas in Jusons nel 1970. In questo quadro, gli enti fisici perdono il loro statuto di referenti del discorso, in quanto già inseriti nel piano del linguaggio. La partecipazione di una cosa a un'idea si manifesta infatti primariamente nell'acquisizione del nome dell'idea da parte della cosa. La possibilità di considerare le idee come segni, che rinviano ad altro, mi sembra giustificata in questo passo dal carattere fondante dell'idea rispetto alla cosa. La cosa non è né può essere in sé, ma è sempre in relazione all'idea a cui partecipa. Il referente del mondo naturale in questa prospettiva è limitatamente a questo passo, e il mondo eidetico, e attraverso l'ipotesi degli eide si invertono referente e contenuto. Le cose sono espressione degli eide. A questo punto, per trarre una breve conclusione, possiamo sviluppare le suggestioni di questo passo. L'ipotesi degli eide, posta in questi termini, indica la possibilità di portare alla luce la struttura binaria delle relazioni tra idee che sono organizzate per opposizioni. Non solo, l'omologia tra eidos ed ente fisico porta a una considerazione semantica di entrambi, nel senso che entrambi sono posti all'interno di una struttura relazionale e da essa traggono il proprio significato. Ma ancora, porre questa omologia contempla anche la possibilità di vedere attraverso gli enti fisici le relazioni tra eide, ovvero la possibilità di porre una fisica degli eide allo stesso modo in cui si può porre una semantica del mondo naturale. La struttura e l'articolazione degli elementi fisici nel passo del Timeo, infatti, sono analoghe a quelle degli enti e delle idee nel passo del Fedone considerato. Se le cose hanno le proprie determinazioni in base alle idee alle quali partecipano, i processi fisici ai quali le cose danno luogo saranno omologhi ai processi ai quali danno luogo le idee. Questo è il senso del verbo apergasestai usato per descrivere l'azione delle idee. In conclusione, ci possiamo chiedere: cosa accadrà all'idea del tre all'avvicinarsi dell'idea del dispari? Certamente, non potendo perire, si allontanerà e cambierà luogo, proprio come gli elementi differenti del timeo. Grazie.
Thank you, Silvio. Now we are going to have 10 minutes for discussions, opening for Q&A.
Grazie, in italiano, grazie Silvio. Io ho una domanda e un suggerimento. La domanda è, se ho capito bene, tu interpreti in senso abbastanza debole il verbo apergazzo, cioè come omologia, come richiamo, come se fosse un parallelismo, diciamo, tra il piano delle idee e il piano delle cose. Ho capito bene o
se no? No, che l'idea agisce e quindi rende, diciamo, una cosa ciò
allora,
che è l'idea.
Perfetto, no, volevo...
Cioè questa era...
Sì, sì, allora...
Cioè di un'azione.
Di un'azione vera e propria, perché il termine Ergon chiama questo aspetto. No, il suggerimento era di andare a vedere il passo di questa misteriosa settima lettera, che probabilmente non è platonica, ma cristianamente è complessa, in cui il termine pragma sembra riferirsi esattamente all'idea, cioè a quello che Platone chiama topempton, il quinto livello, che sarebbe l'idea. Non è così esplicita la cosa, però è possibile che appunto qui il termine pragma indichi l'idea.
Non sarebbe
l'unico
caso, perché anche nel Fedon
c'è pragma.
Voi.
Buonasera, faccio la mia domanda perché in italiano. Vorrei capire bene ciò che hai detto, se pari dispari sono per lei idee o qualità dei numeri. Spiego, per esempio, faccio un paragone con Teteto, dove Teteto divide tutti i numeri in due classi, quelli dei numeri quadrati e quelli dei numeri equilati. Quindi se quando Platone insomma parla di pari dispari oppure quadrati e equilateri, sono qualità dei numeri o per adesso sono idee? Vorrei sapere questa cosa.
Io penso siano idee, cioè nel senso che se noi scomponiamo, cioè per esempio io sono italiano e quindi io sono partecipo dell'idea, diciamo, dell'italianità, se così si può dire, ma sono uomo e quindi partecipo dell'idea di uomo, cioè è un complesso di partecipazione, laddove, forse come per usare la definizione, io sono un animale razionale, no? Laddove il fatto di essere uomo, insomma, non esclude, cioè, anzi, implica per forza delle altre cose, delle altre qualificazioni, una partecipazione a un complesso di idee, perché altrimenti non potrei essere quello che sono, almeno dal passo del Fedone. Quindi diciamo, il problema è che ogni idea porta con sé delle relazioni con altre idee, per cui insomma è questo ho cercato di argomentare nel paper.
Questo è stato il mio dubbio, per esempio una sola idea può essere partecipare di altre idee, perché per esempio 3, 5, 7 sono tutti dispari e ognuno è, diciamo, io penso così, questa idea di pari dispari, anche essendo un'idea, da una parte non definisce il numero, quindi il 3 è il 3 in sé, non perché è dispari, perché è il 3, è anche dispari, ma lo stesso vale per 5, quindi sono idee partecipando di idee.
Di idee, sì, perché il 3 si trova a essere 3 numero e dispari, perché il 3 è un numero, perché il 3 è il porta in sé delle idee una partecipazione coessenziale, e quindi quello, diciamo, il problema si struttura proprio a partire dalla partecipazione, diciamo, seconda, va? Chiamiamola così, diciamo, la partecipazione coessenziale, perché a questo livello, diciamo, questo secondo livello, che c'è il livello della contrarietà, della contraddittorietà. E per cui, diciamo, ho cercato di mostrare come in realtà in questo passo è come se la strutturazione degli Eide sia una strutturazione binaria, quindi sì, no.
Grazie mille. Prego.
Grazie Silvio, provo a fare l'idea.
No, va bene in spagnolo lentamente.
Muy interesante el vínculo entre la parte física de Timeo y el Fedón. Me parece siempre muy curioso en este pasaje particular del Fedón, que la ejemplificación que hace Platón no la hace sobre particulares, ¿no? Como por ejemplo la reminiscencia toma los leños, son dos leños particulares, o la cosa bella en el comienzo del método hipotético, donde se trata otra vez de particulares, sino de, vos llamaste entes físicos, claramente, la nieve, pero no exactamente un particular, sino la nieve, lo que nosotros en español llamamos un sustantivo colectivo, es decir, que no tiene una referencia particular. Y en el Timeo, la descripción de la formación de los entes físicos pareciera también referir ya a particulares. Me pregunto si cuando vos hablas de que con esta interesantísima hipótesis de que pragmata significan las ideas, ¿crees que desde el Fedón al Timeo hay una reflexión platónica sobre el valor del particular? ¿No? En el Fedón hace probablemente esta reflexión que vos haces, pero sin tomar como ejemplos particulares.
Ok, e quindi nel Timeo poi ci sarebbe questa riflessione.
Sì. Una pregunta
non. Beh, il problema è che Platone riscriveva le cose, quindi, diciamo, quindi sono molto cauto in questo, a dire questo. Quello che mi interessava era portare alla luce una strutturazione, quella lì anche degli elementi del Timeo, per brevità non ho letto quei passi, ma quei passi sembrano, cioè sono praticamente di fatto considerano un diverso come opposto, e quindi in genere una lotta, diciamo. Lì secondo me il problema è proprio, cioè nel Fedone parla di pragmata, quindi di cose, di neve, cioè di enti fisici composti, occupati da varie idee, insomma, proprio per mostrare secondo me questa complementarietà, questa semanticità, questa omologia che vi è secondo me fra questi due piani, quindi non una specularità ma una semanticità, cioè l'ingresso della cosa, come tu anche dicevi ieri, cioè analizzavi proprio all'inizio di questo passo, cioè quando noi vediamo, percepiamo semplicemente il mondo fisico, noi lo percepiamo, insomma quella sedia non è una cosa, ma noi la riconosciamo in quanto, diciamo, è occupata dall'idea di sedia, e quindi noi la possiamo, che se non avessimo la categoria la categoria di sedia, l'idea di sedia, noi non la potremmo riconoscere come sedia, diciamo, questo secondo me è il problema fondante, e che quindi c'è, cioè, nel momento stesso in cui la partecipazione di una cosa a un'idea, diciamo, la prima cosa che accade è che la cosa prende il nome, quindi già siamo inseriti un ambito linguistico e quindi un ambito semantico, perché poi dobbiamo spiegare per esempio che cosa è una sedia e quindi cosa significa una sedia, qual è il referente, quindi se l'idea occupa la cosa e la determina, noi abbiamo una precomprensione che è linguistica e concettuale della cosa, e quindi non è un ente fisico brutto così come la chimica o la fisica lo spiegano, ma è già un concetto, è già una precomprensione linguistica concettuale, con questo, non so se...
Or in French?
A forse.
Voilà. J'ai un problème avec votre conception de la sémantique. J'aimerais bien savoir comment vous comprenez le signe. Votre thèse, c'est que les choses physiques signifient les idées, qui seraient le référent de la signification. Mm-hmm. Alors, les choses sont les semi-nomina, les idées, ce seront les semi-nomina.
Oui.
Mais en fait, les choses physiques sont quelque chose qui change tout le temps.
Qui change
tout le temps. Il est difficile de concevoir que ce sont les choses sensibles qui sont les signes, parce que les signes doivent constituer un réseau stable. Alors ce sont les noms qui sont les signes. Et dans tous ces textes, et dans le Védon, et dans le Dîné, ce sont les noms qui interviennent entre les choses et les idées. Et ce sont les noms qui désignent les idées, et qui peut-être peuvent référer aussi aux choses. Alors, il y a un niveau des noms, il y a un niveau du logos qui doit être introduit pour élaborer une théorie de la participation en termes d'une sémantique.
Bon, là, j'essaie de reprendre. Si j'ai compris. Non, c'est trop peu. Et si je comprends bien, les choses sensibles changent. Ça, c'est le problème, tandis que les noms restent les mêmes. Bon, j'ai pris tout ça, c'est une suggestion que j'ai pris. J'ai pris de Grimas, quand Grimas est la sémiotique du monde naturel. Bon, ce que je peux dire, c'est qu'à un certain moment, j'ai 36 ans, par exemple. Dans ce moment, je peux me référer à moi-même comme si j'ai en ayant 36 ans. Bon, alors que quand le temps avance, je ne vais pas dire que moi j'ai 36 ans. Je crois que là c'est une tentative que j'ai essayé de faire, c'est clair, parce qu'en fait même le carré sémiotique marche un peu mal avec cette structure. Mais ce que je voulais faire est donner, référer des. Disons, un paradigme pour élaborer, disons, ce que Platon voulait affirmer ou ce que le texte affirmait. Donc, comment on peut insérer ce passage, cet extrait, dans une conception sémantique. Parce qu'en fait, quand Platon dit la chose est occupée et prend le nom de l'idée, là, il y a déjà une pré-compréhension, je dis, linguistique et conceptuelle. Le problème qu'on peut envisager, c'est que tout ça relève de la phénoménologie, en fait, et les catégories, par exemple, la première, qui est la catégorie typique ou proprioceptive. Et là, vous voyez bien, parce qu'en fait, les noms, là, le projet de Grimas, c'est de faire une taxonomie de SEM, c'est-à-dire qu'il n'est pas possible de faire une taxonomie globale. Parce qu'en fait, et là, tout ça relève de l'anthropologie culturelle, parce qu'en fait, les SEM et les types de relations changent de culture en culture. Alors là, je m'arrête dans ma réflexion conceptuelle et dans ma réponse. Merci.
Sorry about that. We're running short of time. So now we're moving on to Federico Maria Petrucci. His talk is entitled There Should Be a Virtue for Everyone, Non-Philosophical Virtue in the Philo. Federico Petrucci has a PhD in philosophy from Pisa University. He has been a Humboldt Fellow in the Institut für Classique Philologie of the Universität of Würzburg. And now he's a temporary research fellow at the Scuola Normale Superiore in Pisa. He has published papers in Plato in various journals. He translated the Seventh Tetralogy and the Gorgias. He's a specialist in Middle Platonism, He has translated and commented on Bion's Expositio, published several papers on Middle Platonist exegesis, and he's now writing a monograph on Taurus. He also studies musical theories in ancient philosophy with Francesco Pelosi. He is working on a collection of sources from the pre-Socratics to late antiquity with a translation and a commentary.
Thank you, Anastasia. Thank you all for being here, and hi to those who are seeing us through the live broadcasting. And thank you for preferring Plato to Breaking Bad or something like this. And well, but the topic is worth hearing since it's virtue. Natural qualities, if they are combined with correct education and suitable nurturing, render one perfect in respect of virtue, but if one neglects them, they become the cause of evils. These, Plato was accustomed to name homonymously with virtues, temperance and courage and justice. At the beginning of his handbook, Middle Platonist Alcinous ends with these words, his portrayal of the ideal philosopher, who is characterized by true virtue. By implication, he who is not a philosopher has only great evils and despises, which Plato describes in the same word he uses for true virtues. Alcinous clearly expands on Phaedo 68-69, where Plato opposes non-philosophical virtues, Euethes, Rosune, and Andrea Delia, to philosophical virtue. Alcinous' view was probably conditioned by many factors, not least the typical Middle Platonist tendency to regard non-philosophers as non-initiates, hence as impure individuals subject to vices. Such a view, however, has often been upheld also in contemporary scholarship. In Asparez, it has been claimed that only the philosopher's virtues, whereas the pursuit of non-philosophical virtue, is to be condemned as mere hedonistic calculus. Alcinous' passage helps clarify how strong this view is and to what consequences it leads. If only philosophers partake of virtue, there is the risk that all other people are prey to vice. But should we assume that according to the Phaedo, no one but the philosopher can be virtuous? Such a restrictive view is puzzling from at least two points of view. First, from a philosophical perspective, Plato's ethics would imply a huge gray area encompassing the vast majority of people who wouldn't necessarily be seen to act badly. In other words, Plato would be depriving his own politics and ethics of any contingency plan for non-philosophers. On the other hand, such an account would substantially weaken Plato's ethics from the point of view of factual evidence, since it is clear that at least some people whom Plato would not take to be philosophers act virtuously. These are some of the reasons why virtue must also exist for non-philosophers. Scholars have already made this argument, above all on the basis of the Republic. In this paper, I shall rather suggest that the Phaedo too introduces such a philosophical idea. I shall detect the positive import of non-philosophical virtue, which, far from amounting to mere hedonistic calculus, positively allows non-philosophers to act virtuously, even though only philosophers are virtuous. At Phaedo 68-69, Plato outlines what non-philosophical virtue consists in. Plato develops his argument about Sophrosyne and Andreia by emphasizing the factors distinguishing their poor forms from authentic ones. This distinction is much more nuanced than is usually believed. This emerges first from the way in which Plato introduces the authentic Sophrosyne, belonging only to true philosophers. It is to veritas epitomias mento este, alonigoros eke in kakos mios. Although this description identifies philosophical Sophrosyne, and only philosophers are able to attain this virtue, common people, evoloi, do accept it. It must be the case that common people grasp some aspects of true Sophrosyne, but miss its true core. So, there is something of Sophrosyne which both philosophers and common people are able to identify, although only philosophers are in a position to really understand what this something amounts to. Indeed, being impossible with respect to passions and having an orderly moral conduct refer to a practical way of acting and to specific evaluations, but do not say anything about the internal reasons determining such behaviors and evaluations. The same way of acting, outlined by the shared definition, can have two different motivational bases. This is confirmed by the way in which Plato introduces the idea that only philosophers have what Andrea is according to common people. What is commonly referred to as courage really belongs to those who practice the melete thanatou, i.e. the philosophers, thanks to their internal state. Also in this case, there is an aspect of courage which must be recognizable to everyone, and this aspect coincides with the internal disposition determining courage, which belongs only to philosophers. In consequence, the common distinguishing mark of courage must be a sort of visible, clear behavior which does not immediately reveal its internal motivations. If this is correct, Plato's distinction between true virtue and non-philosophical virtues is much more subtle than is usually held to be the case. Plato wishes to emphasize that the two share common aspects, namely similar ways of acting and visible behaviors, while diverging in a more important respect, that is their internal motivations. Against this background, we can approach Plato's account of non-philosophical Sofrosyne and Andrea. Non-philosophical Andrea is the one leading man to face death and is determined by fear of written evils. Non-philosophical Sofrosyne implies that men govern some pleasures because they opt for other, greater pleasures. It is widely acknowledged that Plato is referring to the calculation of pleasure and pain. However, it is probable that this is not the most important point here. Both accounts are based on the contrast between two aspects. On one hand, Plato stresses the wrong motivation grounding a particular behavior. On the other, each virtue manifests itself in a way of acting which is virtuous. While the negative characterization of the motivations is all too evident, regarding any course of action which reflects non-philosophical virtues as something negative or wrong will produce a clear inconsistency. But if this is the case, how is it possible to mistake actions driven by non-philosophical virtues from those mirroring authentic virtues? One could argue that such confusion is only to be found on the part of common people, but we have observed above that common people are indeed able to grasp some aspect of true virtues, namely their manifestation as forms of behavior and actions, which Plato shares. Therefore, although non-philosophical virtue is characterized by a wrong motivational system, it does eventually lead to acting virtuously, that is, to some kind of actions which are produced by philosophical virtue. Indeed, just after outlining non-philosophical virtues, when Plato reveals what intrinsically distinguishes true virtue, no reference is made to actions. Rather, Plato insists on the motivations or cognitive basis of philosophical virtue. My good seniors, I quote, "I fear this is not the right exchange to attain virtue, to exchange pleasures for pleasures, pains for pains, and fears for fears, the greater for the less like coins, but that the only valid currency for which all these things should be exchanged is wisdom, phronesis. With this, we have real courage and moderation and justice, and in a word, through virtue, with wisdom, whether pleasures and fears and all such things be present or absent." In Plato, phronesis often coincides with knowledge, and this is well observable in the first part of the Phaedo, where phronesis indicates a superior cognitive state, which typically belongs to the philosopher, and in particular to his soul, and which is directed towards pure, non-material objects. The philosopher is said to reject an involvement with sense perception because his body and senses impede the exercise of phronesis, and this is by implication the proper and most profitable activity for the soul, which, when leaving aside the senses, can grasp purer entities, that is the usia. In turn, the body, both as a source of passions and as a weak and deceiving perceptive instrument, is the main obstacle for exercise of phronesis and for tentuontos thean. Now we can better understand in what the gap between philosophical and non-philosophical virtue actually consists. It is a matter of having access to the true being by leaving aside all obstacles generated by the body. If this is the case, however, our distinction is again collocated at the level of intrinsic motivation. philosophers will act coarsely or with temperance because their acting is dictated by a qualified internal state shaped by phronesis, while non-philosophers will act coarsely or with temperance because their acting is determined by the calculation of pleasure, pain, desire, and fear. From all these, three important consequences follow. First, the gap between philosophical and non-philosophical virtue has nothing to do with respective ways of acting, which accordingly must coincide. Nonetheless, Plato does establish a strict cutoff between levels of virtue, which is based on an internal quality state. Reducing the gap between them from a practical point of view does not undermine the peculiar nature of philosophical virtue. Finally, Plato indicates the range of people who are in a condition to attain true virtue, that is, those who have phronesis, are free from the limitations of the body, and can grasp through being, in a word, through philosophers. This might seem obvious, but actually represents a fundamental point for Nantecoforo and Molloy, Marco de Paolo. Even admitting that it is possible for men to be philosophers in this life, the cognitive state enabling men to go through virtue can be attained only by a very restricted minority of people. But at this point, this is no more a problem, for Plato has provided men with a second best on the basis of which to act. There is no philosophical virtue. This is the fundamental positive function of his ethical doctrine. My interpretation is also supported by another passage. After the three provisional proofs of the immortality of the soul, Plato briefly outlines the destiny of each kind of soul after its separation from the body. A first kind of soul is that of the philosopher, which is free from any bodily contamination and attains a godlike state. By contrast to this, there are a wide range of souls who do not spurn contact with the body and the material world. Now, since these souls are those of non-philosophers, they essentially amount to all souls apart from those of a very small minority. A distinction then is necessary from a theoretical point of view, and the standard which Plato applies to identify the best non-philosophical souls is the exercise of popular and political virtue. I quote, 82A11B3, the happiest of these who will also have the best destination are those who have practiced popular and political virtue, than the Vatican per politica noretem, which they call moderation and justice and which was developed by habit and practice without philosophy or understanding. Ex etus de cameletas venuian anion philosophias de canum. The kind of virtue which Plato refers to here could hardly be the true virtue of Phaedo, 69ab. If this were the case, we should admit at least that the virtue which is explicitly ascribed to philosophers, coinciding with the soul's purification and belonging to only to a small group of Bacchae, is not taken to be popular and political and to imply a huge involvement with the body. Rather, the best candidate for demotica and politica rete is the non-philosophical virtue which we have been describing. It is anion philosophias de canum, and is definitely lower in value than philosophical virtue. Hence, it ensures the capability of performing actions which can be defined as virtues, and of gaining an ethical condition which is a sort of second best with respect to that of philosophers. The noteworthy point here is that, once again, the difference between philosophical and non-philosophical virtue must consist in the internal state of the agent, and cannot be reflected in specific actions. If this were the case, Plato would be saying that these people possess no virtue at all. To put it the other way around, if non-philosophical virtue is a virtue, it must share some aspect of philosophical virtue. If this shared feature is not the internal state of the agent, it must consist in an agent's specific mode of acting, or otherwise, nothing will really distinguish non-philosophical virtue from vice. But what Plato is doing here is precisely distinguishing virtues, non-philosophers, from other philosophers. Therefore, non-philosophical virtue implies virtues acting, albeit based on non-philosophical motivations. One could still wonder whether the idea that also non-philosophers can act virtuously runs counter to Plato's intellectualism, which is actually strongly confirmed by the decisive role ascribed to phronesis at Phaedo 68-69. Things are more complicated, however. A man who is completely virtuous will also act virtuously. Yet, his being completely virtuous is not a necessary condition for virtuous acting. On the contrary, it might be the case that phronesis is a necessary and sufficient condition for being virtuous, but only a sufficient condition for virtuous acting. Therefore, it is possible for someone to act virtuously, albeit without phronesis. Non-philosophical virtue is another sufficient condition for virtuous acting. This makes Plato's intellectualism much more effective. Although phronesis remains a gold standard from both an ethical and epistemological point of view, it is possible in principle to act virtuously also for the majority of men who are not automatically condemned to vice. All this raises further questions. Although these deserve to be the object of a more extensive analysis, it is worth pointing them out and briefly outlining some solutions. It is quite astonishing that at Phaedo 68-69, non-philosophical virtue is said to be based on a calculus of pleasure and pain, while at 82a, it is grounded in ethos and melete. Now, a calculus of pleasure and pain is based on some kind of reasoning, albeit a necessary imperfect one. Although such a calculus is developed individually, there may be some precepts or general rules that make it more likely to prove correct. Consider, for instance, the case of a man who must decide whether enjoying a pleasure at the moment will damage him, since it will compel him to abstain from future pleasures. Or consider the case of a man who must decide whether to enter a desperate battle or make a cowardly retreat. In both cases, the man in question will have some belief as to what he should do based on empirical evaluations, previous experiences, education, or a system of social rules considering parameters for his calculus. All these elements make up a corpus of beliefs which every individual possesses by force of habit and practice, and which ultimately stems or could stem from his social education. This is probably the reason why Plato says at Phaedo 68b, 69b, that non-philosophical virtue is based on a calculus of pleasure and pain, while at 82a he states that it is grounded in ethos and melete. Both motivations are aspects of a single cognitive state, one based on belief. Moreover, since the Phaedo non-philosophical virtue is not based on phronesis, the cognitive state which it must be related to is some kind of belief shaping and orienting ethos and melete. This would also help understand a subtler practical difference between philosophical and non-philosophical virtue with respect to acting. Given that knowledge implies stability, those who are perfectly virtuous will always act virtuously, which means both constantly and in all possible situations, while those following their beliefs will act virtuously only as long as their beliefs on the matter are correct. Such a distinction, while preserving the fundamental features of Plato's epistemology, does not undermine the practical and political effectiveness of non-political virtue. We have now obtained a definition of non-philosophical virtue in the Phaedo. It consists in acting virtuously and is not based on phronesis or any of the intellectual states belonging to the philosopher, but depends on a close relationship with the body and is grounded in a calculus of pleasure and pain, in ethos and melete, or more generally in belief. Such definition allows us to solve the philosophical puzzle which opened the paper, for this non-philosophical virtue is the very means allowing common people, potentially everyone, to act virtuously. In other terms, far from being an equivocal way to refer to vice, or a sort of travesty of philosophical virtue, the Phaedo's non-philosophical virtue also has a positive payoff in Plato's ethics and saves it from substantial theoretical problems. One could wonder why, then, it is at face value presented in such negative terms in the Phaedo. The most reasonable explanation is that in the whole dialogue, Plato is committed to emphasizing the correctness of the philosophical way of thinking of death and of life, and its cognitive requirements. Moreover, the dramatic context would have made superfluous to insist on the positive aspects of non-philosophical virtue since Socrates' interlocutors are presumably people aspiring to become philosophers and already possessing a good, albeit imperfect, internal state. And this is probably the most astonishing aspect of the story. In Phaedo, where the philosopher, the truly virtuous man, seems to be celebrated and totally abstracted from normal politics, Plato acknowledges that barring the vast majority of people, non-philosophers, from any participation in virtue is a philosophically unsuitable option and offers an effective solution to this fundamental problem.
On what basis
you equate once that you get a CCA something with H2.
Actually, this is what I've been trying to do in the paper, probably it's not enough. My point is that those who act according to the virtual 6869 do act correctly. The result in the action is correct.
Where did you hear that?
Yes, but in the motivations, not in the result. In the motivations, I do agree that motivations are slavish, but result in terms of action. He says those who act correctly according to this calculus are not philosophers, but they do act correctly. Actions are actually correct. The motivations are not. We will discuss.
I think I might get to something a little bit similar, but maybe from a different tact. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, good. So thanks for the paper. I enjoyed it. I agree with a lot of it. I do think it's worth considering the point that Beatrice brought up, and you might take a look, I think, Terry Irwin and Chris Babanich and Cecilia have got positions on this, on the identity between those two passages. So that would be worth looking into. But one place I wanted to pressure you on is the idea that people with demotic or non-philosophical virtue necessarily perform the same actions that people who have philosophical virtue perform. You pointed to some evidence at the beginning. I don't know if that's definitive. But it would sort of be an awkward thing to maintain. If you look at the Republic, for instance, it seems like philosophers do different things than exoters. Look at the Theaetetus aggression. There's very much a different way that philosophers behave from ordinary people. So that could be one, and just one way of putting that pressure clearly could be to say, in virtue of what can you ascribe to someone non-philosophical virtue? Is it because they always act exactly how a philosopher would act? Is it because they sometimes act? Or is it because they possess, say, a disposition to attempt to maximize pleasure in their life? Is that what makes you have demotic virtue? It seems like that will come apart from the behavior of a philosopher.
My point is that those who act coarsely or rigidly according to belief, of course, will not always act coarsely. But if they have a correct belief which fits in a situation, they will act coarsely. Of course, philosopher, knowing what justice is, have some good basis to always act coarsely and to evaluate courage. But my point is that in this way, Plato can exclude that only philosophers act coarsely. If one accepts the opposite thesis, one has only philosophers acting coarsely, and no one else would be in a position, in no case, to act coarsely. Since someone, albeit not being a philosopher, does act coarsely, there must be some philosophical device allowing him, in some cases and situations, to act coarsely. So, of course, there is a strong difference between these two figures. But with respect to acting, to being courageous acting, actions are identical. My further point is that, of course, Plato.
Questions, actually, and I would like to give a proposal for everyone. So.
Yeah. Love to talk more.
So I think I have a...
Slow, please.
Yeah. I think it's a fairly simple question. So it looks like in the Protagoras say, but in a lot of dialogues, it's by a virtue that we're virtuous. So it's by courage that we're courageous. It's by justice that we're just. And he seems to hold that as a general view across a lot of dialogues. So are you denying that that's true here? Because it seems that you're suggesting that we can, in some ways, be, that the action can be courageous, but that there's no courage there by which it's courageous. So that's the question.
Yes. I would say that in these cases, and when we have such expressions, that is referring to virtue. This depends on the fact that, of course, one is virtuous, in the way you say. But it is logically and empirically impossible that all great virtuous actions, that is, actions which one can evaluate as virtues, depend on the possession of knowledge of justice. It is, well, let's imagine the case of a man in a battle. I know why I am a philosopher, I know why I must escape. And then there is another man who is afraid, is scared, and escapes. Actions are exactly identical. They both escape. Motivations are different. Of course.
Just to clarify, when you say that some education or habits could form some beliefs, would you accept that this features an internal state of the agent? And so it's a particular kind of neurotic virtue that it's an internal state when it's produced by beliefs and education and customs. Would you say that? Because this is preliminary to my real question.
Preliminary, I would say yes.
because what Professor Post said, there is this virtue based on calculation, and there is this demonic virtue based on, I believe, customs, education, and beliefs. I would like to clarify for me if you take this second kind of demonic virtue to correspond to an internal state, or not?
Yes,
because you relate the virtue with some kind of internal state in a point.
Yes.
This virtue based on belief corresponds to this internal state.
I think that belief is the internal state determining a way of acting, but not belief itself possessing belief, so not being a philosopher, not having knowledge. All these cognitive state determines case by case one's acting. And in some cases, when your beliefs are fit situations, you will act coarsely.
My real question is it, does it suffice to produce virtue, even the market virtue? It seems to be that in the Republic, the preparation is to act upon the souls to produce the real ordering between the elements, among the elements, so that there can be justice in the soul of the citizens. And not only a kind of coercive production of beliefs that will amount to actions.
I totally agree
with you. I totally agree with you.
But for example, the guardians in the Republic are virtues or have courage thanks to education. So in some sense.
I don't know. Many thanks, Enrico. Very short question. As this analysis on demotic virtues or demotic levels of virtues, something to do with the practical perspective of the field.
Yes, of course. It's a way to save a practical nature also for those who are not philosophers. It's a way to cover all fields, all ethical fields, all parts of the spectrum. Ethics, so to say, and of course it has indeed a protective nature and function.
Thank you.
person who asks people to stop talking. I'm trying to be virtuous here. So now let's go to our third paper. Chad Jorgensen, his paper is entitled Philosophical and Political Virtue in the Phaedo and Afterwards. Chad Jorgensen is collaborateur scientifique at the Centre Léon-Morin in Paris. He did his undergrad studies in the College of Humanities in Carleton Universities and in Louvain, and his graduate studies at the Université de Freiburg, which stays at the Topoi Center in Berlin and Christ's College in Cambridge. A reworked version of his dissertation entitled The Embodied Soul in Plato's Later Thought is forthcoming with Cambridge University Press. His current research bears on the problem of character and action in Stoicism, including its relation to Plato's later philosophy. In September 2016, he moved to the Instituto per il Lexico Intellettuale Europeo e Storia delle Idee in Rome.
Okay, thank you very much. So I get the second stab at political virtue, and hopefully we won't cover too much the same ground, but it will be to some extent complementary. So the Phaedo presents us with an image of the ultimate goal of human life as involving the separation and purification of our rational soul through the practice of philosophy. This portrayal conflicts, at first glance, with the definition of human happiness as justice in the Republic, and justice as an equilibrium between the soul's three constituent parts, the legistikon, the thumos, and the epithymetikon, which implies the existence of a correct measure of affection, such as pleasure, pain, anger, and fear. If the Phaedo acknowledges the existence of drives for preeminence and material wealth, alongside desire for knowledge, it does not portray them as originating in parts or kinds of the soul, much less suggest that they should be accommodated or balanced against the interests of the rational soul. Instead, they are taken to reflect an unhealthy orientation towards the body that binds the soul to the material realm. Those inclined to emphasize the continuities in Plato's thought are likely to gravitate towards books 5 to 7 and 10 of the Republic, where the vocabulary and imagery employed by Socrates is much closer to that of the Phaedo. In books 5 to 7, it is a question of training philosophers who liberate themselves from the metaphysical cave in which they are imprisoned through the progressive purification of their cognitive powers until they are able to ascend, at least intellectually, to a higher plane of reality. Along similar lines, in Book 10, the soul is compared to the sea god Glaucus, mutilated and encrusted through prolonged immersion in the sea, whose true form is difficult to grasp. If we latch on to these passages and connect them to the Phaedo, with the idea of presenting a unified account of the philosophical life in terms of the purification of the intellect, we need to explain the insistence on the importance of an equilibrium within the tripartite soul in the earlier books of the Republic. One solution to this problem, first proposed to my knowledge by Plotinus, is to distinguish between two different kinds or levels of virtue. In the Phaedo, mention is made of demotic or political virtues that stand in contrast to the true virtues cultivated by the philosopher. Plotinus takes these political virtues to have the function of imposing a measure of limit on the affections associated with the body and the two lower parts of the soul, while the true virtues are the virtues of the purified rational soul, which is also purified from its lower parts. The fact that the vocabulary of political virtue is taken up in the Republic lends support to this view, which has found some measure of acceptance among contemporary commentators, even if they do not share Plotinus's broader philosophical commitments. However, while the distinction between political virtue and true virtue is explicitly made by Plato, and while the Plotinian reading has a certain plausibility in the case of the Phaedo, I am less convinced that it maps onto the distinction between the virtue of the tripartite embodied soul and the virtue of the purified rational soul that plays a central role from the Republic onwards. The key passage on political virtue from the Phaedo at 68 to 69, we can talk about this in the questions, has generated substantial confusion. The first part of the passage, which defines political virtue in terms of the exchange of pleasures against pleasures, pains against pains, and fears against fears, calls to mind the account of virtue proposed in the Pythagoras, where Socrates suggests that it consists in the correct calculation of the magnitudes of pleasure and pain resulting from any particular course of action, such that we maximize our share of the former and minimize our share of the latter. The reason that this leads to a form of moderation, even if from the point of view of Phaedo it is a false or demotic moderation, is that we tend to judge pleasures or pains in the near ordinary, I should say, we ordinarily tend to judge pleasures or pains in the near future to be greater than equivalent pleasure or pains in the more distant future. The result of this nearsightedness is a reduction in the overall share of pleasure and increase in the overall share of pain in our lives. As we indulge in pleasures that destroy our health and avoid beneficial pains, such as those of exercise. The life in which pleasures genuinely predominate over pains is therefore one of moderation rather than indulgence, even if its ultimate foundation is the pursuit of pleasure. Already in the Protagoras, this view of virtue is connected to hoi-polloi, as Socrates repeatedly emphasizes, although he does not directly state that it is a lower form of virtue that is at issue here. In the Phaedo, by contrast, this demotic conception of virtue is critiqued on the grounds that it is incoherent. Those who are moderate in this sense do not take the good to be something fundamentally different from those who are immoderate, since both set up the experience of pleasure as the highest goal in life. The difference between them lies in the fact that the moderate are more clear-headed than the immoderate, and are better able to avoid falling into the trap of short-sighted gratification. Crucially, this form of moderation does not derive from a critical attitude towards pleasure, but from an embrace of it. The demotically moderate abstain from certain pleasures, not because they are bad, but out of fear of being deprived of other pleasures. In a reversal of the claim in the Protagoras that we are never overcome or conquered by pleasure, Socrates states of those who possess false moderation, it happens that, while being conquered by pleasures, they conquer other pleasures. The situation is similar in the case of demotic courage. The bravery of the warrior in the face of death is fundamentally different in kind, and not merely in degree, from that of the philosopher. For while Socrates believes that death is ultimately a good thing, the warrior is driven to confront death even though he fears it, because he is even more afraid of dishonor. Just as the demotically moderate are moderate through their susceptibility rather than indifference to pleasure, so too are the demotically courageous courageous through their susceptibility rather than indifference to fear. At 68 to 69, the emphasis is squarely on the opposition between this form of virtue and properly philosophical virtue. In the absence of phronesis, which I'm translating wisdom here, this juggling of pleasures and pains and fears appears to be an image and truly slavish, containing nothing sound or true. Yet when lower forms of virtue are mentioned again in the context of a description of the fate of the souls after death, they are presented in a more positive light. Therefore, he said, those who have practiced demotic and political virtue, which they call moderation and justice, originating from habit and exercise without philosophy and nous, are the happiest of these people and go to the best place. Socrates goes on to explain that they are the happiest because they will be reincarnated as bees, ants, or some other social animal, and then again as moderate humans, andras metrios. If gluttons, robbers, and tyrants lead bestial, subhuman lives, a fact that is colorfully reflected in the animal forms they assume, those who possess political virtue appear to live a quintessentially human, or at least social life. While this life does not measure up to the properly philosophical life, the way it is described here seems to give lie to the earlier hyperbolic assertion that political virtue contains nothing sound or true. In opposition to this exchange of pleasures against pleasures and pains against pains, Socrates expresses the essence of true virtue in a rather cryptic formula, which we'll hear a lot about, I think. But perhaps this alone is the correct currency against which it is necessary to exchange all of these other things, wisdom. The wording of this passage, and particularly the use of exchange for, suggests that what is at issue is exchanging pleasures, pains, and fears for phronesis, in the sense of purifying ourselves of the former in order to obtain as much as possible of the latter. Yet what renders this passage so problematic is the use of money in the analogy, particularly since Socrates goes on to say that true virtue consists in buying and selling with this currency. Instead of selecting something unambiguously valuable in and of itself, Plato appears to muddy the waters by choosing the example of something that normally serves as a measure of the value of other things, and indeed a means of acquiring them. Of course, it could be argued, albeit somewhat awkwardly, that phronesis provides the ultimate measure of value in that, according to this measure, phronesis is the only truly valuable thing, such that the dominant idea would be that of selling all we have in order to stock up on phronesis. Nonetheless, this is not the only possible interpretation, even if I'm inclined to think it actually does fit best in the immediate context. When Socrates criticizes what they call temperance or justice, he does so on the grounds that they come about through habit and exercise without philosophy and nous. The question is whether their demotic character is due to their origin in habit and exercise, or rather to the absence of philosophy and nous. In other words, are the political virtues fundamentally defective and in need of replacement, or do they merely lack an essential ingredient, phronesis, or nous, which would transform them into genuine virtues? In the latter case, wisdom would be conceived as a measure of value, if not as a unit of exchange. These themes are taken up in Republic 4 in the context of a discussion of the courage of the auxiliaries. Courage is initially defined as a sort of preservation, soteria, specifically the preservation of the opinion produced by law through education concerning things that are to be feared, both what they are and of what kind. This result is brought about through the education of the auxiliaries in music, including poetry, and gymnastics, described in books 2 to 3, which on the analogy Socrates draws, so comprehensively dyes their souls that not even the powerful detergent of pleasure can wash it out. Socrates hastens to clarify that what is at issue here is political courage, politikenge. What makes this form of courage merely political? No explanation is forthcoming in the passage, but the subsequent discussion of moderation provides a clue. While no explicit mention is made of political moderation, a contrast is drawn between the many and variegated desires, pleasures, and pains found in the unwashed masses, and the simple and moderate ones, which are guided by calculation along with nous and true belief, found in those with the best nature and the best education. The city as a whole is moderate because the desires of the many are vanquished by the desires and phronesis found in the better few. Thus, whereas the moderation of the philosophers is a product of their possession of nous and phronesis, which limits them to simple and moderate pleasures, pains, and desires, the moderation of the many is imposed by force or constraint through the political institutions of the city. If the citizens internalize this moderation through their civic education, through their education, propaganda, and habituation, this is not the same as possessing genuine understanding of why they ought to behave in a certain way. Here I'm quite in agreement with my colleague. Similarly, in the case of political courage, what is missing is any reference to nous or phronesis. While the philosophers possess nous and true opinion, the auxiliaries possess only an ingrained opinion concerning what is right or wrong, derived from the law and their education. But of course, the great defect of the law, in Plato's eyes, is that it provides only general prescriptions that cannot give the correct result in all cases, because it cannot take into account particular circumstances. It is always to some extent rigid and imprecise. And we might add that it's also to some extent unstable, because in the myth of error at the end, those who are virtuous through political virtue end up choosing the life of the tyrant. Not all of them, but it's possible. What then would the true courage of the philosopher be? Would it consist in a properly calibrated thumos guided by nous and true belief, instead of by the imperfect beliefs drilled into the auxiliaries? Or would it consist in a purification of the rational soul from the thumos itself, as Plotinus would be inclined to argue? One passage that could be induced in favor of the latter view is found in Book 7, where Socrates says that the other virtues that are said to be the soul appear to be close to those of the body. On the grounds that they are acquired through habituation or practice, once again, in opposition to the virtue of the soul in the proper sense, which possesses a uniform power that can be beneficial or harmful, depending on whether it is directed upwards or downwards. If the language used in this passage recalls the Phaedo, with talk of reorienting the rational soul, or the soul, some listener, if we have a unified soul here, towards the truth and shedding the weights hung on it by becoming. It also defines the excellence of the rational soul not in and of itself, this is in the Republic, but in terms of its usefulness. So, for instance, when it is a question of turning the eye of the soul towards the truth, this is framed in terms of making it useful and beneficial, tresimon te kai ophelimon, rather than pure or happy per se. Much as in the Timaeus, the education of the rational part is said to be undertaken in order for it to be able to fulfill its function of governing well, its function of pedagogia. Moreover, there's no suggestion that the other virtues stand in opposition to the virtue of the rational soul, as political virtue stood in opposition to true virtue in the Phaedo, or indeed in the earlier books of the Republic. The point seems to be rather that wisdom has greater intrinsic value than the other virtues, and belongs to the soul in a more proper sense. While courage, moderation, and the like are first acquired through habituation and training, they only become true virtues when the soul as a whole is governed by philosophical reason, and in the absence of further philosophical education, they will remain on the level of political virtue. Nonetheless, they appear to constitute, in political virtues, an indispensable foundation to true virtue. The philosophers do, after all, go through the same curriculum as the auxiliaries. Such a reading preserves the continuity between books 5 to 7 and 10 and the other books of the Republic, as well as with the later dialogues such as the Timaeus, especially since Plato does not, to my knowledge, explicitly retract or qualify the thesis that happiness results from justice and that justice is an equilibrium between the three parts of the soul. It also avoids one of the most problematic aspects in the account of political virtue that identifies it with the virtues of the tripartite soul. As Plotinus recognizes, Plato does not contrast moderation, courage, and justice as political virtues with wisdom as true virtue, but rather contrasts two forms of moderation, courage, and justice. If we say that political courage is the courage of the tripartite soul, then we must say that the rational soul possesses, for instance, its own distinctive courage when it is separated from the body. This strikes me as improbable, at least in the context of the Republic, since it would undermine the brilliance of the solution to the problem of the unity and the multiplicity of virtue that Plato presents here. What then are we to make of political virtue in the Phaedo? If we take the reference to love of honor and love of money to indicate that tripartition is lurking in the background, then it would make sense to emphasize the continuities with the Republic and stress that we can talk about purification in terms of the purification of our reason in its hegemonic function, such that the good rather than the pleasant or the fearful becomes our motivating principle. If, however, we take the Phaedo to be operating with a unitary model of the soul, as I'm inclined to believe, then it is possible to attribute all the true virtues to the rational soul in line with earlier Socratic dialogues, with the consequent problem of explaining why there are several of them. It need not surprise us if there's in fact a divergence between the Phaedo and the Republic on this point. Plato exhibits great ingenuity in repurposing old concepts to serve new ends. If political virtue appears to be introduced in the Phaedo, primarily in order to emphasize the contrast between those who are normally seen to be virtuous and the genuine virtue of the philosopher, in the Republic, it gains substance as a theory of habituation, underpinning not only the education of the auxiliaries, but also of the future philosopher kings. At the same time, it points ahead to the vast political project of the laws, and to the surprising portrayal of vice as mental illness in the Timaeus that is to be cured by training and habituation. If explicit references to political virtue in the dialogues are few and far between, its subsequent theoretical importance, I suggest, is far greater than its humble origins would indicate. Thank you for your attention.
Virtue taken from the point of view of the city, which makes
another sense, maybe, and it makes the video and the recording not so incompatible as you seem to argue. I mean, in the video, the reincarnation of the lower souls are these or Gregorian beasts. We can imagine that in a way, the political virtue is also a way of producing virtue collectively.
I think to some extent, I mean, I think it's hard to interpret political virtue in the theater precisely because it's not a political dialogue. But in the passages that I mentioned with the Republic, where he talks about political courage, for example, there we have a parallel discussion about what courage looks like in the city collectively. So what it looks like when a city is courageous. And also it seems to me, at the same time, we're talking about what courage looks like in an auxiliary who's an individual within the city. And so there seems to be a recognition that in the best city, not everyone can be virtuous. And so the philosophers, I think we all agree, are virtuous. How do we take that? They possess virtue and habit. But we do have the problem of the lower parts. And so in the Republic, and I think also in the Laws, we develop the theory of education, of how we can instill some form of virtue in people who can't attain philosophical virtue. And I think this connects with the discussion of political and demonic virtue in the Phaedo. But there he's, aside from this mentioning the bees and the ants and stuff, he's not really interested in theorizing as part of the politics, but just to draw the contrast. And that's why I don't see a strong disjunction between 68, 69, and 80, whatever it is, 82, because I think in the first case it's kind of a hyperbolic rejection of demonic virtue. Look how many more times glorious philosophical virtue is. But then when it comes to evaluating forms of human life, then we can say, well, yes, there is a distinction, and that people can be better even without being philosophers.
So much, and with this one too. I had a question, I just thought as you were speaking. You mentioned that in the Republic, it seems like political virtue is tied or more to law, to an historical standard that sort of determines actions, whereas in the Phaedo, it doesn't seem like that's the case. It seems like it's the person's own reasoning or their own habits that determine what actions they perform. I'm wondering if you think that's an inconsistency, or do you have anything to say about that?
I don't think it's necessarily an inconsistency, because, for example, if we look at non-ideal political unions in the Republic, so like democracy, which seems to represent a sort of idealized version of Sparta and Crete, so that there we have legal prescriptions that produce a sort of virtue that's not entirely sound, a sort of a militaristic virtue that involves repressing the appetitive soul that's endowed by the law, but at the same time, you know, when they get the chance, they indulge in these sorts of appetitive pleasures. So I think you could transfer this idea back to the Phaedo and say that, yes, on the one hand, this idea of, I think, calculating pleasures and pains and everything like that, I think there we're looking at this sort of internal motivation, so from an agent living under a particular political regime, you know, I want to maximize my pleasure, let's say I'm appetitively driven, I want to maximize my pleasure, but I have to behave in a certain way because there's all sorts of social injunctions or possible punishments, possible bad results that could end up making my life miserable. So we have that internal perspective, and then when we turn later to when we talk explicitly about political virtue, we're looking, you know, from the outside and saying that, you know, it's the political regime ultimately that pulls the strings, like at the beginning of the Laws, you know, that manipulates our pleasures and pains in order to ensure that we act in a particular way. So I don't think there's, even in the Phaedo, I don't think it's really individualistic, but I don't think he theorizes really the political dimension. I think we have to look elsewhere for that.
Just to clarify, the definition D mentioned law, political virtue.
Sorry?
The definition of political virtue D mentioned law.
I don't know. in the veto, I don't know. I think later on he'd be inclined to talk in terms of general rules, laws that we, of conduct that we absorb to a greater or lesser extent from the political regime. I don't know if he'd require that in the veto.
Hi there. To be very clear, do you think there's any sense here in which non-philosophical or pre-philosophical virtue for Plato is a necessary requirement for the development of phronesis or the orientation towards the intelligible?
I think it is. I think, certainly if we look to the city of the Republic, like if we look in Philippolis, there it seems that we have to, like the philosopher kings undergo the same education as everybody else, you know. And there's passages where he talks about that the importance, I think towards the beginning of the Republic, in the description of the auxiliaries of education, that it's very important to have the correct true beliefs at the beginning, and then later on we can become philosophers if we can, you know, go a step higher. Under the right conditions. And certainly in the Timaeus, there's a section I mentioned briefly about mental illness, vice's mental illness, and there he says that the origins of vice are to be found in physiological defects and in corrupt political regimes. So in the case of someone like Socrates, it's a little unclear what happened, given that he was in grew up in a corrupt Athenian environment. But I think as a general principle of, you know, political philosophy, he thinks that, yeah, this political virtue is a stepping stone on the way to true virtue.
I think that in the Republic, Plato has a quite ambitious vision of how to produce democratic virtue, in contrast to the optimism of Protagoras, the character of Protagoras, which thinks that if you put someone in a city with customs and laws and coercion, you would attain this demotic virtue. I think that Plato in the Republic thinks that demotic virtue, the production of demotic virtue, demands a true intervention in the soul, in each element of the soul of the citizens, meaning that by poetic education, I convey to the rational element some beliefs. By associating honor to the same beliefs, I make this two ideas element natural aligned to reason. And deflating the pleasures of the city, limiting them to necessary pleasures, I eliminate the tension that would be between Epitometicon and the other two. So I can produce justice as reason commanding and the aid of two ideas and the harmonious compliance of Epitometicon.
Yeah.
Does it make sense?
No, I think that's substantially right. And I mean, the biggest issue with demotic virtue is that it's held together by true belief rather than by knowledge. And I think this is why Plato inserts this reference that I mentioned earlier to the person who's politically virtuous in the myth of the air, who chooses the life of the tyrant. Because when he's within a certain social political context, with the beliefs he's absorbed and, you know, the sorts of motivations that are present, then he can behave virtuously. But when he's placed in a situation like the Ring of Gyges, which is substantially what the myth of the air is, then he's tempted by the tyrannical life because he hasn't understood fundamentally what's wrong with it. So, that's right.
Yes, a brief question. You seem to, I'm sympathetic to your view, but you seem to think that power in the Republic, you know, somehow presents some kind of, or establishes some kind of a discontinuity with the Phaedo, some kind of inconsistency, incompatibility with the sentence of virtue. And I was wondering how exactly that's supposed to work. You talk about balance and equilibrium, and that you don't have three parts, you don't have a balance. And you know, so do you think that somehow just the language of the three parts of the soul gives more weight? I mean, to the lower parts of the soul, or the desires that stem from the lower parts of the soul. At one point, you said, I think they're balanced against the rational part. And what another way of looking at it is, say, well, you know, organized and subordinated to the rational part. And I mean, so, so I'm just wondering what you see more in the Republic as a system.
Yeah, I'll say, so in the Republic it is the idea of an equilibrium between the three parts that's put forward as the definition of justice and of happiness. Now, in the case of the city, that clearly requires a certain sacrifice on the part of the highest class, so the philosopher kings have to rule even though they don't want to. The question is there an analogy in this case with the soul? Does the rational part have to make certain sacrifices to rule the lower parts of the soul? I don't know in the Republic that there's any answer given to this. In the case of the Timaeus, there's a really interesting passage where he talks about a sort of rational incontinence, when we dedicate ourselves too much to the cultivation of the rational soul at the expense of the body, and he treats that as something fundamentally bad. And so I think there is an idea that there's a trade-off involved even in the Republic, and that in that sense, the view that we find there contrasts somewhat with the Phaedo and the notion of a purification, complete purification of the rational soul. But that said, I don't have a very strong view about the Phaedo. I do want to insist, though, on the importance of the equilibrium within the tripartite, against people who would argue that in the Republic, too, once we get past Book 5, then it's also about a purification of the rational soul from the lower parts on the beginning lines.
Thank you very much for your paper. I would like to ask you a question, because you mentioned the end of the Chavras, the Majority Eterne, as calculating pleasure. So, but in the Chavras, the definition, Plato equates virtue and wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
So, Fia pronounces, he says many words, but does he mean? So, when he conceives the Majority Eterne, and he says that it has to do with pleasures and pains and the more and the less, but he equates that Majority is the same as wisdom. And then we take the passage of the Phaedo where he's opposing this calculating pleasures and pains and fears and these things, exchanging, and opposing that to promises, to wisdom, to what it. So, what I want to ask you is, the problem is not calculating, because Sophia, or promises in the Protagoras, is Petrus-Gentene, is calculating. And what we calculate is apparently the same, pleasures and pains and fears and this and that, and more or less. So the problem is not calculating, but the calculus is wrong. I think that what Plato is saying, that if you have phronesis, the calculus is right.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't have phronesis, you fall in this kind of skagrapia, which is just aberrant virtue, which is nothing to do with virtue, and it should be rejected.
Yeah.
So, do you agree with that?
To some extent, yes. I mean, the problem is in the Pythagoras, there is a calculus aiming to maximize pleasure and minimize pain. In the Phaedo, if there is a calculus, it's a calculus about how to have zero pleasure or pain, to minimize both. And I think in the honestly, my opinion of the Pythagoras is that it's not Plato's view, even at the time he was writing the dialogue, but that he's showing that even if we take this sort of idea of maximizing our pleasure to be the virtue or the good, then we still arrive at a position of moderation. Then in the case of the Phaedo, I mean, we rule out any sort of pleasure, any calculation of pleasure, anything like that. But I think the idea does come back a little bit in a dialogue like the Philebus. And there it's not really calculating, but there we have the idea that kind of nous seems to act as the measure of everything, including pleasure at a lower level. So it's not, we can't have this, yeah, metodic technique bearing on pleasure, but yeah, we can make use of this idea of nous as a measure of all things and including pleasure. And so we pick up kind of a faint trace of the Protagoras.
Well,
yeah.
So the key
is measured.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, of course.
Of course, yeah.
So we need to close this session now. And we will have the opportunity to discuss later on. We have to go straight to the bus. Get this reboot to the conference. No, first of all, there's another session. Another session that is about to start. I'm sorry.